Some of the things that I was thinking about why this could potentially be another planet. So we have lots of critters in the Tolkien universe that grow particularly tall. We've got things like Ents and elves. So maybe this planet actually has lower gravity. And especially there's critters like dragons. Those things are huge. How do they get in the air? How do they stay there? I think lower gravity would help them stay airborne, don't you?
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. Hey folks, I am back with Dr. Emily Gilbert, a postdoctoral fellow up at JPL in the Exoplanet Exploration Program office. I remembered the whole thing. Welcome back, Emily.
Thanks, Jesse.
So we just established that your favorite fictional planet is Middle Earth. Talk to us about Middle Earth. What do we know about Middle Earth?
We know a lot of things about Middle Earth. Fortunately, we got a lot of books and movies that we can pull content from here.
There's a lot of words. Tolkien wasn't skim writing here.
So we got a lot of content to pull from, but some things that I think make it interesting as a planet that we could potentially start thinking about in terms of exoplanets. We know it has big mountains on the planet that they have to climb in parts of the books. So that means there's probably plate tectonics moving on the planet. There's a very active volcano. Maybe we can
Right,
see
we know there's
evidence
a
of
volcano.
volcanism.
Yes.
We know there's liquid water on the surface. There's lots of animals and people and different types of critters. So
Right.
lots of fun things going on here.
Yeah, and honestly, it's a lot of different life from life on Earth, which might tell us something about the evolutionary pressures on Middle Earth.
Exactly. So some of the things that I was thinking about why this could potentially be another planet. So we have lots of critters in the Tolkien universe that grow particularly tall. We've got things like Ents and elves. So maybe this planet actually has lower gravity. And especially there's critters like dragons. Those things are huge. How do they get in the air? How do they stay there? I think lower gravity would help them stay airborne, don't you?
There you go. Does that mean there's no dragons on super Earths, though?
Ooh, that would be really sad. I really hope that there are dragons out there in the universe on the super Earths.
Me too.
Another thing that I was thinking about is that a lot of the characters in these stories grow to be really, really old, 100 plus years old. Some of the elves, thousands of years old. So maybe a year on Middle Earth is actually shorter than an Earth year, and that's how they get to be so old.
Oh, that feels kind of like cheating. So when it's Bilbo's like 111th birthday, it's not really that many years?
I mean, it could still be his 111th birthday, just his years are shorter. Just spitballing here.
Okay, so Middle Earth, so we think it's a rocky planet in the habitable zone of its star, but that its period might be shorter. So that means it's probably not a sun-like star to be still in the habitable zone. So we need a cooler star. We think it's volcanically active, lower surface gravity.
Yep.
Those are the things we're aiming for.
Yes.
Okay, so I went into the NASA Exoplanet Archive and I found the closest real-world analog to Middle Earth. And I'll start by saying that I think listeners now of the show know that we haven't found any truly Earth-like planets around other stars yet. It's the goal. It's the holy
grail.
We're
trying our best.
It's why we're here. But we don't truly have anything Earth-like yet. But we do have, let me bring it up, bum-ba-da-bum. We have found Kepler-378c, which is our carbon copy for this week. So Kepler-378c, what do we know about it? It's a rocky planet that was discovered by the NASA Kepler mission in 2014. 2014 was actually after Kepler had finished observing its original field of view. So this was actually found looking back in the archival data once the mission was done. Kepler-378c, you'll note the C means that it's the second planet in the system. So there's at least two planets in the system. Both of them transit, both of them pass in front of their star and block some of the light. The closer one in has a short period of about 16 days. So why did we choose Kepler-378c? Why is it similar? The ways in which it's similar to Middle Earth, it is smaller, so it's only about 70% the size of Earth, which means
little baby planet.
Little baby planet only has little baby surface gravity. So you can grow some really tall elves, you can grow some really tall ants, you can hopefully fly some dragons if you're on Kepler-378c. Also, importantly, it's orbiting a star that's about 1,000 degrees cooler than our sun, so it's a K-dwarf. So it's not quite in the habitable zone of this K-dwarf, but it is a cooler star. This is as close as I can get, a small rocky planet around a K-star. As close as we can get to the habitable zone is still too hot. So it's about 150 degrees hotter than the Earth's equilibrium temperature, with an equilibrium temperature of about 414 Kelvin. So that's toasty. But we know Middle Earth has volcanoes. We know Middle Earth has Mordor. So just imagine the entire planet is like the inside of Mount Doom. Right? It's toasty. So you're going to be hot and sweaty, and you better hope you have a Samwise Gamgee with you when you need him. In order for Kepler-378c to have the same temperature as Earth, it would need to be about twice as far away. So where we found it, it has a period of about 30 days. It would need to have a much longer period in order to be habitable. But that's as close as we get. That's our carbon copy this week, Kepler-378c, rocky planet near the habitable zone of a K-dwarf. Hooray!
Good find in the archive.
Yes. But back to you, Emily. Okay.
Yeah.
Are you still looking for planets?
Always. We got,
what are you working on now?
So right now I'm actually working to try and measure the masses of the TOI 700 planets. That's really exciting because up until now we've been using test data, which gives us the radius of the planet. Mm-hmm. And so if you know the radius of something that you presume is a sphere and the mass of something, then you can calculate the density of the planet. And mm-hmm. so with the density of the planet, you can get an idea of what the planet is made of. So we can study the compositions of these planets and get some ideas about how the planets formed and how the system evolved over time.
Okay, so you're working on characterizing TOI 700 system before you go looking for more planets.
Yes, but okay. As we mentioned before, I'm a member of the TESS team, and TESS is constantly spitting out new planet candidates. So I think we're up to close to 7,000 TESS objects of interest right now.
Yeah, it's a lot.
It's every time I get one of those emails, I'm like, it's too many, stop.
But the next one might be the one.
It could be. So we're going to keep looking.
Right. Speaking of keeping on looking, is there a fictional planet you'd really like to find?
Ooh. So I've been thinking about this, and I think one that would be really fun would be technically a moon, not a planet. Pandora mm-hmm. from the Avatar movies.
Sure.
So very cool system. Pandora is a moon that's orbiting a gas giant. So we could potentially see evidence of moons around exoplanets, too, in some of our data.
That's true. And we're actually working on something called Pandora. Do you want to tell them about it?
So Jesse and I are both science team members of a mission called Pandora. And Pandora's goal is to disentangle some stellar weirdness from signals of what we see in exoplanet atmospheres. So if the surface of the star is not exactly uniform and pristine like you want it to be, which is the case more often than not, it might contaminate your planet atmosphere signal, and you might get some false positive signals in your data, and you don't want that.
Yeah, so for instance, there were just these really big headlines from the NASA James Webb Space Telescope a month or so ago about they found water in this spectrum that they took, but they couldn't tell whether the water was coming from the star or the planet. And so the goal of Pandora is to help us understand when and why this happens and how we can separate them.
Yep, so it's a small sat that should be launching in roughly 2 years, and we're both really excited to get some science out of it. I know.
Yes. Yay. Oh, we're blinking. It'll be up there. That'll be great. Thank you so much, Emily. It's time to come to the questions from the audience. We're so glad everyone's listening and curious about exoplanets. One question we got that I thought Emily would like to tackle is, why do we concentrate on looking for planets around sun-like stars?
Yeah, that's a great question. I actually, in my research, focus largely on M-dwarf stars. So those are stars that are roughly half the size of the sun and smaller. But sun-like stars are our number one priority for looking for life because we have one data point for life in the universe, and it's Earth. So we're looking for planets like Earth. So Earth size in an Earth temperature regime around sun-like stars.
Mm-hmm. So why aren't we looking around M-dwarfs, though?
I mean, I'm looking around M-dwarfs. I think M-dwarfs are the best. But there are a lot of reasons why people are justifiably potentially a little skeptical. So one reason is that M-dwarfs are known to flare for really long portions of their lifetime. So these are increases in stellar brightness that emit a lot of radiation that might be harmful to life and planet atmospheres. Mm-hmm. So you get a lot of things like UV radiation and X-ray radiation, which, as we know, could be harmful to life on the surface of these planets. So flares might not necessarily be great, but we also think that you might need some amount of UV radiation in order to kickstart life in the first place. So indoor flaring is not necessarily a deal breaker.
Right, so TOI 700D, which we established in the previous segment, is your favorite real planet. Just because it's in the habitable zone of an M dwarf doesn't mean it's not habitable.
So we're not sure if it's habitable or not, but it is in the habitable zone. For one thing, we do know that TOI 700 hasn't flared in any of the 3 years of observations that I've been observing it. So that's a good sign. And another thing that people are potentially concerned about with M-dwarfs is that planets in the habitable zones around M-dwarfs are likely tidally locked. So that means the same side of the planet always faces the star, similar to how we always see the same face of the moon.
Why is that a problem for life?
Yeah, potentially a scary thing for life because people are worried that on the night side of the planet, the side that's always facing away from the star, it could be really cold. And so your atmosphere might condense out. And then on the day side of the planet, it might be really hot. And so you might end up with something like a runaway greenhouse like we see on Venus that could be really harmful to life on the surface of the planet and make the planet really, really toasty.
But in modeling we've seen, that's not always the case. And I've always thought, if I were life, intelligent life, that had evolved on a tidally locked planet, and I was looking for life in the universe, and I found planets that weren't tidally locked, that were spinning, and, you know, the temperatures were wildly changing from day to night to day to night, I would think that was weird. Like, how can life evolve on a planet that the temperatures are swinging by hundreds of degrees every day? That's always made me feel strange.
Maybe we're the outliers. I think it'd be really nice to be able to travel from day to night whenever you want, or maybe get, like, nice expensive real estate on the Terminator. So right where it switches from day to night, you get this constant sunset.
Just a sunset all the time.
So sounds pretty. Beautiful. I would love that.
Okay, so move over to San Francisco real estate. It's the Terminator of a tidally locked planet where the most expensive real estate will be.
Surely that's got to be it.
So thank you so much, Emily, for joining us today and for your time. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. If you want more Out of This World content, please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, where you can send us your burning questions about exoplanets, real or fictional, and beyond for us to tackle in an upcoming episode. Bye.
Bye. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you.